For everybody who's here, welcome. For everybody who isn't here, I hope you're doing something good with your time. But for all of you who are here, thank you for joining us. So Matt Padditz is a computer scientist, a theoretical computer scientist at the University of Arkansas. He got his PhD at Iowa. But he works in this really interesting area of DNA and self-assembly, which is fascinating because a lot of people who started out as theoretical computer scientists are starting to play with actual DNA in the lab and get strands of DNA to fold up and do cool things and make boxes and machines and stuff like that. And I suppose some of this is happening in the opposite direction too, with people who are used to bench work starting to learn some computer science. So he's here this week because he was a keynote speaker at a yearly conference on DNA computation, which took place at UNM this past week, or is still taking place. And so as a great twofer, we invited him to come up here and give us a talk as well. So he'll be around this afternoon if anybody is intrigued and has the time and interest to speak with him, and take it away.
Yeah, thank you so much. I'm ecstatic to be here. I've always wanted to come to the Santa Fe Institute. I mean, it's a place that it's already, you know, it's not disappointing. And I had a pretty you know, ridiculous picture in my head of what it's going to be like. I'm loving it. But
You know how good the lunch is.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, exactly.
That fulfills.
I'm glad we got here early enough. Yeah. We were cutting it close, but we made it. So I'm a theoretical computer scientist, which kind of means I'm not really good at computer science. I'm not really good at math. So I kind of slot myself in between the two and, you know, kind of hide out. But like Chris said, you know, there's this area where, you know, as a theoretician, you know, we kind of get this, you know, mathematical background of, you know, and we study computation from, kind of, you know, what we like to think of as fundamental principles of computing, and kind of, in a cool way, there's this area of DNA computing and molecular programming has started coming up, you know, relatively, you know, recently in the last, you know, couple decades. And it gives us this kind of playground where, you know, we can, you know, we can try to, actually realize some of our ideas of, you know, what does it mean to compute in these kind of very, very different manner, you know, not using silicon and you know, digital circuits and stuff. So that's what I'm gonna talk to you a little bit about today. It'll be kind of a mathematical abstraction to some implementations that have been done in DNA, but the cool thing, what I really like about it is, you know, it doesn't have to be done in DNA. DNA is just it's a molecule that's very easy to work with, and so we use it. But these ideas, you know, are hopefully, you know, more abstract. They don't only apply to, you know, if you build it out of DNA, you can build it out of hopefully all kinds of different things. And it serves as some sort of a model for things that might be going on in all kinds of natural systems. So, just out of curiosity, are there any computer scientists in the room? Just like anybody? No. Okay. Cool. So,
I play one on TV.
Okay. Yeah. Cool. Okay. So, I would love this to be, you know, a pretty interactive talk. So I'd be happy, you know, if you know, something isn't making sense or you have a question, please just, you know, immediately, you know, just speak up or throw something at me or whatever. And we can chat about it. So self-assembly is kind of the framework that most of my studies fall under. And, you know, and it's a process where you have you start with a disorganized collection of relatively simple components, and they autonomously combine to form some sort of a structure. You know, that's kind of the generic, you know, definition of a self-assembling system, you know, so it's you know, autonomously, so that the interactions, you know, are you know, they're not guided by some outside entity. It's just the local interactions and complexity, you know, emerges as a structure builds. And one of the, you know, one of the things that's cool is in nature, there's all kinds of self-assembly. Self-assembly is occurring on all kinds of scales and levels of complexity. And that's really where we got our inspiration from. You know, so, you know, crystals, like snowflakes, they self-assemble, right? It's just you know, little, you know, droplets of water, and you still get this amazing like six-fold symmetry, and there's all this complexity, and it's still not completely, you know, understood exactly how, you know, how and why you get this, you know, the crystalline structure, and you know, but I mean, it's a self-assembly process, right? There's nobody etching out the shape and looking, okay, that side looks like this, so I want to make it look. It's just this spontaneous process of self-assembly, and you get this, you know, this complexity, and as complex as this is, it's kind of on the lower side of complexity of natural self-assembling systems, because in biology there's you know, self-assembly occurring as well. But you know, when a virus goes in and it commandeers the resources of your cell and gets it to build the proteins that make up the virus, and then those proteins self-assemble into more copies of the virus, you know, so it can propagate and move on. And so, you know, so that the components are, you know, that they're self-assembling these kind of, you know, much more complex and perhaps, you know, kind of dynamic components of the proteins, you know, are kind of the base, you know, constituent components, as opposed to, you know, just the droplets of water, right? So again, you know, a pretty big spectrum of self-assembling systems, and this is where we kind of got our inspiration. I want to do this too. You know, I want to make something self-assemble. So, the way that I'm going to come at, there's all kinds of ways to look at self-assembling systems. And as a computer scientist, I like to focus on, you know, one of the properties of self-assembling systems that we find very interesting is the way in which they reuse components. So, for instance, you could make a structure like a puzzle where every single piece is unique to the location in which it goes, right? We call this hard-coded or fully addressed self-assembly. You know, there's one copy of this puzzle piece for each copy of the puzzle that's made, right? I mean, every position has a unique component that's specifically designed for that. And like even in this virus, that's relatively similar. Like some of the legs, they're the same, but there's still like a whole bunch of unique pieces for the most part that come together and make this. So that's kind of one end of the spectrum where there's really almost, you know, little to no component reuse. And then another, you know, kind of direction is you know, periodic, right? You've got some base set of components and they're just reused over and over in some sort of repetitive pattern, right? Like it's just, you know, just, oops, that's what I meant to do. I meant to click, you know, so it just, you know, just goes off, you know, it to infinity, right? It copies out. And here's some kind of diagrams, schematic diagrams of what we call tiles. And I'll kind of define tiles a little bit more concretely here in a bit. But these are strand diagrams of DNA. Hopefully, you know, everybody, I would assume everybody in the room has at least seen the helix, you know, double helix of DNA. We're aware of that. Well, you know, in biology, you know, DNA is used to store information, and it exists almost, you know, completely in this, you know, long helical structure. But we can actually take DNA and use the fact that A's, you know, so you can think of it as a ladder, right? A twisted ladder, and there's the rungs, and the rungs are, you know, an A binds to a T and a C binds to a G, right? And so we can use that property of DNA, and we can make strands that don't just make, you know, a twisty helix, but we can make all kinds of funky things by getting strands to weave in with each other. And so, for instance, you know, you can make these components that you know, where the DNA comes together, makes this little Y, and then those combine with each other to make this periodic lattice. And you know, you can do that with different shapes. And so that's another, you know, type of system where, you know, it's this periodic behavior, just that, you know, there's some relatively small set of components that just over and over attach to each other and make this kind of repetitive structure. Okay, so those two I consider boring, right? Okay, so because you know, as a computer scientist, I like algorithms and you know, information processing, right? So that's where that's where the computer scientists come in, and we want to figure out how algorithms can come into this game. So here, what we can think of is like a computer program, you know, will consist of some finite, you know, some constant size number of different instructions, And as the program executes, those instructions, you know, in some order, they're executed. And oftentimes the same instruction, you know, will get executed a whole bunch of times, maybe with, you know, different values of variables, but the instruction, you know, the same instruction, you know, repetitively gets executed. But there's still, it's not, you know, at least in most programs, it's not just kind of runaway periodicity, just copies over and over, just to say you're stuck in an infinite loop that just goes over and over. But it'll be kind of guided, like, oh, we'll do this for a while, these instructions for a while, and then we'll branch over and we'll do some other set of instructions. And so, you know, this you know, kind of the execution of an algorithm. And it turns out that, you know, we can, and the model I'll be introducing, we can design components that kind of behave like the primitive instructions of a program. And as they come together, the order in which they combine to build a structure is like, you know, we can see the execution of the program, the algorithm actually being intrinsically embedded in the growth process. And we'll see examples of that. So the pattern could be some, you know, could make some finite thing, it could make some infinite periodic thing, or it could make an infinite aperiodic structure. So it's even more complexity. And these are the kinds of things that I'll be demonstrating. And so just as a teaser, as a theoretician, you know, I'm usually out here kind of on the, you know, the mathematical end of things to talk about in the limit we can do this, and, you know, and you're motivated, you know, by loosely attaching it to some sort of physicality. But the cool thing is in this particular domain of DNA computing, people are actually doing this. So when I give examples here in a bit of like, we're going to see how to make, this is actually a binary counter. If you can interpret the white and gray spots as bits, the whites being ones and the grays being zero. And this is actually, you know, in each slice of it is a number encoded in binary. And the next row is the number greater than that. So like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So the algorithm is embedded in the growth. And we'll go through exactly this example here in a bit. But these are other examples of algorithmic self-assembly. So Dave and Damien, this is one of their most recent, they'll be here for a workshop next week. This is their work. And then there's some other stuff that we'll see examples of this. So just to tie it a little bit to, you know, because now I'm going to move off into the mathematical definition of the model. But this is to say, like, people can do this, not me, like, I, you know, but some people can make this happen in a laboratory.
So on that, I don't know, I just want people to see, because it's a little bit faint.
There.
There's four gray images there. Like, there's this Sierpinski triangle there. Which is a classic triangle.
Yeah, that's right. And I'll show the example of how we get the tiles to make this. But yeah, thank you. Yeah. So it is a really, so hopefully you can kind of see the triangular structure, and we'll see how to build that actually. So really, you know, this stuff is fascinating. So the model that I'll be talking about is what we call the tile assembly model. The guy who's kind of credited for looking at DNA and saying, yeah, nature uses it to hold information and just has this helix. Ned looked at it and said, wow, the binding properties, the fact that A's want to stick to T's and C's to G's, you know, and so it's a programmable molecule. If we give it different sequences, we can get it to do different things. So Ned saw this in the 80s. Unfortunately, he just passed away last year. Today at the conference is a tribute to Ned. So we kind of consider him as a person who got this whole area going. And so here is an example of just a molecule or a DNA molecule. But what's happened here is we've got four different strands. I've just colored them so you can, you know, it's easy to see where, you know, which is which. And here, this little portion is just the regular old double helix that we're used to. Right here, this would be the, you know, the three-dimensional structure that you're used to seeing. But the idea is, what happened is, if you design like this yellow sequence such that it is complementary to half of the sequence of the red, so, you know, its A's and T's and C's and G's are, you know, complementary to half of the red, but then the other half of the yellow is complementary to half of the blue and half of the blue to the green, et cetera. And so what happens is if you, and so this is something we can do relatively cheaply and easily. I mean, you can just email a company and say, hey, I want a strand of DNA that's the sequence, A, G, G, C, G, G. You know, you can give them the sequence and they can print the DNA molecule that has that sequence. And so if we do that, if we design four sequences such that, you know, they have this complementarity to each other, you know, half and half, and you throw them in a test tube and you cool it down, you know, to appropriate temperature, they'll start binding with each other, and you'll get a whole bunch of copies of this thing. They'll find each other, they'll bind, and they'll self-assemble to form the structure. This is called a holiday junction. So Ned realized that, yeah, so we can make complicated things, much more complicated than this, but this is a nice simple example. And then a computer scientist, you know, stumbled into his lab, Eric Winfrey, who gave you the bio, right, with origami. He said, man, when I see this, you know, I see that, you know, this is a complex three-dimensional molecule, but I can kind of envision it like kind of logically as this flat square, right? And I'm just going to think of it like that. And I'm going to kind of ignore the fact that this is actually, you know, a three-dimensional helix and, you know, and there's this twist and stuff. I'm just going to think of it like this flat molecule. And what you can do is you can design it so that, you know, these pieces are complementary to each other, but then there's a little bit that's sticking off that isn't stuck to anything else. It's some nucleotides dangling that aren't bound to anything. And so we're gonna call those sticky ends because those are pieces of DNA that want to find their complement and bind to it. And it's kind of energetically favorable if it can bump into another piece of DNA that's complementary to the pieces hanging off, they'll want to bind together. And so Eric said, well, I'm gonna simplify all the way down to just thinking of this mathematically as a square tie, right? Just a two-dimensional square that has some glues, some sticky stuff on the ends. And instead of thinking of them as, you know, like sequence A, G, C, T, where we're just getting variable names and we're gonna abstractly think of them as just squares. Okay. So we don't even have to, you know, really, you know, for the purposes of this model as I go forward, you know, we can think of in the back of our minds, we think, well, here's one way we could make a tile that would behave in a you know, molecular system like the model I'm about to present. But there's other way, you know, it's an abstraction and there's a whole bunch of different motifs that you could use from DNA. And there's hopefully probably other molecules other than DNA that you could get to behave like this. But so our abstraction is just going to be these two-dimensional squares. So Eric defined in his PhD thesis in 1998. You define this model that we'll call the abstract tile assembly model, because there's a different version that I won't have time to get into today. It's a little bit more physically realistic than what I'm going to present, but I'll call it the ATAM because I'm lazy. So the abstract tile assembly model, the ATAM. So in the ATAM, we abstractly just think of our basic components are these squares, and we'll call them tiles. And what defines a tile is just simply just the glues that are on its sides. And the glues have two parameters that are important. One is their type, which is we can loosely, if we want to go back and think of this as being implemented in DNA, but like I said, I like to abstractly just think, you know, we don't even care so much, but if you want to, you can think of, you know, the sequence of nucleotides sticking off is like the kind of the glue, the type. But we're just going to abstractly either represent it as a variable name, you know, X, Y, Z or whatever, or in this case, I'm using color. So I've got a red type of glue and an orange type of glue. So there's a type. And then there's a strength. And in this model, it's simplified and we just make it discrete. So there's that we're gonna give them integer strengths, even though the molecules, you know, you do much more complex analysis of the actual energy of binding of nucleotides, but we're just gonna abstractly say, we're gonna make it so that glues have this kind of a default strength for glues, and we'll call it strength one. And then sometimes on tiles, we'll want a glue that's twice as strong as that default strength, and we'll call it strength two. And the way I'll denote that during this talk is one tab means this is a strength one glue, and two tabs mean this is a strength two. Okay. And now the way that that we can think about this is, you know, we've got these tiles. We can give them labels that are just kind of, you know, so I can say, oh, the L tile or whatever. But that doesn't have anything to do with its functionality. We're going to think of these tiles as not being able to rotate. And now that seems silly because, you know, in a test tube, these molecules are spinning around. They're not going to just always face in one direction. But the idea is we can make it so they don't rotate. They have relatively fixed orientation. So as long as we make it so that every south-facing glue is only complementary to north-facing glues and east to west, you can make it so that whenever glues are going to attach, an east glue could only bind to a west glue. and a north only to a south. And that makes it so that the tiles, we can think of them as having fixed northeast, southwest sides, right? So even though we know that they're really spinning around the test tube relative to each other, they'll always bind in this kind of fixed orientation. And then think of these tiles as floating around. We have some finite, or you know, some finite number of kinds of tiles, which you call it a tile type. And then we think of, in this model, we just abstractly think of it, we have an infinite number of copies of each kind. So they're all floating around. So you know, if we've got a system that has this tile in it, there's an infinite number of that kind of tile, and every other kind of tile that we've defined for a particular system, and they're all floating around and they bump into each other, you know, kind of at random. And when they do so, like if two sides bump into each other and they have matching glues. So in this case, they have a matching red glue, and we say they form a bond via that glue of the strength of that glue. So this is a strength one bond, because it's a strength one glue. So they bind with strength one. Here's an example of binding with strength two. So these two tiles, if they bumped into each other, they could bind with strength two. And then in this case, this is a mismatch. So if these two tiles bumped into each other, they just wouldn't have a bond. There would be a zero strength bond. And they're not prevented from being next to each other. So if they were bound to other things, they could still sit next to each other, and they just have glues that don't form a bond. They just kind of ignore each other. Does that kind of make sense so far? Okay, so then in the model, the only little piece left is we assume that there's some seed structure, some beginning assembly from which growth proceeds. And a lot of times we'll just simplify to saying it's a special tile. But like when we do it in a test tube, we actually make some bigger structure, like on a DNA origami or something that is the seed, and then tiles one at a time attach to the seed and then grow out to make an assembly. So the way they do that is, you know, so there's some seed from which growth begins, and then tiles are coming in and they're bumping into the assembly if they can bind with there's a system parameter we call the temperature, or the minimum binding threshold. And for all throughout this talk, I only care about if that value is set to two. The only other interesting value is one, and we can talk about that as we get further along. But here it'll be two. So that means for a tile to actually stick to the growing assembly, it has to be able to bind with a strength two glue or with two or more strength one glues. Okay, and we'll see an example of that in just a second. But that's it. So in the model, you know, there's a seed and then tiles bump into it. If they can bind, and all the examples I'll use, if they can bind with at least strength two, then they'll stay attached, and then growth can proceed. So let's look at an example system. So here is our tile set. These are the kinds of tiles that we have. I've colored the ones. So we're going to see a pattern that'll pop out. So the ones that I'm considering to represent the binary value one, I've colored yellow, and then I've got some that represent the value zero, and then I've got some other ones that we'll see what they do. So this is, you know, so we assume these are the kinds of tiles we get, and we assume that there's an infinite number of copies of each of these. So we got this test tube, and these things are just floating around. As many copies as you could possibly need of each of these are there. We're going to say that our minimum binding threshold, the temperature value is two, like I said, so they need to bind with a strength two glue or two strength one glues. And then the only other piece that defines a system in this model is, what is the seed? In this very simple example, the seed is just going to be one copy of that tile. So we're going to assume that, you know, this starts and then growth proceeds by tiles coming if they can bind. So our assembly starts as a size one assembly, which is just this. And then as tiles attach, it grows, and tiles can attach if they can bind with at least strength two. So is if people are awake and paying attention, what could happen? So what kind of binding event? So we've got an infinite number of these guys floating around in solution. When they bump into this, does anybody see a tile that could attach by the rules of the game, or they need to have at least a strength two level of attachment?
R is that way and B is that way.
Yeah, that's right, exactly. So a B could attach on the bottom, and an R could attach on the top, right? And they can attach to each other over and over, right? So a B can attach to a B, can attach to a B, and an R to an R. And so since this is self-assembly, it's not directed assembly, we don't get to say the ordering in which this happens. So we kind of assume, like, in parallel, everything that can happen is happening. So there's one seed at which the first attachment is one of these. There's another seed where the first attachment is this, and anything that can happen does. And so growth, you know, could proceed for a while with these kinds of boring attachments where, you know, just, you know, they could go off and tile the axes. That's not very interesting. Where it gets interesting is in this little corner. We call this cooperative behavior, because now once two tiles have come in attached to the seed, we can think of them as cooperating, that geometrically they are positioned such that they expose glues that can allow strength one and strength one can sum to two and allow a new tile to come in and attach. And this we will see is fundamental, important, and this is what allows actually arbitrarily complex Turing universal computation is possible because of this, just because of this cooperative behavior. So, and I'll explain what that means for the non-computer sciences. We'll get to that.
Well, everybody's heard it.
Okay. So where this is interesting is now we're going to think that now, so as tiles attach, they're always going to do so kind of like from this direction, right? Because growth is always going to proceed such that tiles, we think of their input glues, the glues in which they use to initially bind will always be their right and bottom glue. And so we think of those as the inputs. And if we look, there's, you know, if you have two bits, there are four ways to yes.
In terms of trying to develop complexity, is there a reason why your seed only has glues on two poles? Why wouldn't you have just the glueiest seed?
I'm sorry, say that again.
In terms of like developing complexity, why does your seed only have those two poles? Like, why wouldn't you start with the glueiest seed you could?
Oh, but because what we want to, I mean, it depends what you want to build. And so what we want to build is going to be a specific pattern we'll see here. But yeah, okay. you could totally, yeah, you could have more. But what I wanted to build here was,
Okay, thank you.
So what we have here is we have these four tiles are the interesting ones. These are just kind of boring, like, you know, periodic repetitive stuff. These are what do the algorithm. So we can see all possible combinations of two bits, 00, 01, 10, and 11, right? So if you've got two bits, there's four ways to permute them. So those are our inputs. And if we look at any given time, there's gonna be exactly one tile that can fit in that position. Here it has the one and the zero. So this can come in, none of the others can, right? Because they would mismatch with one of the glues, right? And so they would only be able to bind with strength one. So there's exactly one kind of tile that can come in here, and it's that one. And so growth can proceed, and at every step, it'll turn out that there's exactly one tile that can go into every position, and this can grow infinitely far. It could, you know, grow out infinitely far this way and this way. But if we look at the pattern that emerges from this, and I don't know, you know, I mean, how many people are familiar with binary, but I'm just curious, does anybody recognize the pattern? Anybody see it yet? Okay. So when and for those who don't know binary, any representation of numbers, leading zeros don't mean anything. So you kind of ignore the leading zeros, but in each row, there's a number that's encoded. So you can always ignore leading zeros. Here it's the bit one is the, you know, in decimal, this represents one. And then binary 10 is the number two. And then 11 is the number three, the number four, et cetera. This is a binary counter. Those four tiles just by themselves and the rules of the game where they have to match two glues, all by themselves, they're executing an algorithm that counts in binary. So the algorithm of doing binary arithmetic is embedded intrinsically in the way in which this grows. And the way it grows is it makes the binary numbers and it counts to infinity. And so this is an algorithm that's driving the way that this comes together. We've designed the tiles, and I'll go into a little bit more depth of like how those bits work, but it's pretty straightforward. The idea is just by, you know, correctly saying like, okay, if it's a, so essentially what's going on is we can think of the glue on the bottom, you know, here, you know, it is saying, what was the bit position before? The glue on the top says, what is the bit position now? So here in this position, it was a zero before, and now I'm a one. And then we just, the only other thing is we have some carry. So whatever you do, oh, so yeah, yes.
I can see it very easily a scenario that because of the randomness of assembly, that in the third row, for example, you can assemble one at the cell at the second column, and then the pattern will be destroyed.
But it wouldn't stick.
Yeah, that's right.
It would.
No, it would not. So because the only way you can stick is if you match with two glues.
Oh, it's two.
That's right. Yep, that's right. And that's fundamentally important. If you only had to stick with one, we've actually proven, Damien proved, that you can't do any of this stuff. Yes?
Well, I was just going to say, so am I right that the mass grows like the number squared? So the sort of the total tile resources you need to count up is going like number squared. So it's
it's even worse because it goes infinitely far. But what you can actually do in this picture, you can do what we call a log width counter. So this is a fixed width counter. But I could show a more it's slightly more complicated system, and it would be only exactly as wide as the number of bits that you need. This uses 7 tile types, and I think you can do it with like 12 or something tile types. You can make a log width counter, so each row is exactly as wide as the number of bits you need. So you can do that. I just want to show a really simple example. But the cool thing is you can go arbitrarily complex. And here's a fixed width. Constantine Evans made this. This is the same pattern actually as this, but his is only, it's constrained to some number of bits. So so like I said, you know, I was talking about the rules. So when you do any arithmetic, right? When you're adding two numbers, there's a potential for overflow in any base, right? And so if your column has, you know, it's bigger than your base, you know, like, you know, 8 + 2 would be 10. So we carry over into the next column, right? You pass over a carry bit. That's the only other thing that's going on here is we've got our carry bit. So we have the bit that says, what was I before? If I was a zero and I'm not receiving any carry bit from my right, that's telling me that, you know, that it overflowed, then I'm going to stay a zero and I don't pass any overflow to my left. If I was a one and I didn't receive any carry bit, I just stay a one and I don't overflow. If I was a zero, but to the right overflowed, it passed the one into me, then I turn into a one. And then the only other thing is if I was a one and there was a carry bit that came in, well, I turn into a zero and I overflowed to my left. And that's it. Those simple tiles allow this thing when it grows. Force this thing when it grows to execute an algorithm, binary counting, simple algorithm, but a simple set of tiles. So does that example make sense? Do people kind of get cool? Okay, so what we're going to see is so we can kind of think of those tiles as, you know, when we develop them, we define them as, you know, using a truth table. If you've seen this in math or you know, engineering, like, so we can think of our inputs on this side of the table. So, you know, 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1, those are like our input bits. And then these columns tell us what our output will be of some function. We mapped that to a four-sided tile because we have two input bits and two output bits, and we map that to a tile. But we can, you know, abstractly just think of this as a, you know, the definition of a function. And here's binary addition. So exactly doing the stuff I said before, if you were a zero with no carry, you know, you stay a zero and you don't carry out, right? So that's one truth table. And it has, you know, four locations. We can map those to the four sides of a tile like we did. We can also make, so here's a truth table for a logical operation called OR, logical OR. And here, what we're doing is we've got our two input bits, and then I'm just gonna have, I have one output value, and I'm gonna put it in two places. So both of my output bits will always be identical to each other in this particular example. So logical OR says, I output a one if at least one of my inputs was a one. So if they're both zero, I output zero. And if one or both are ones, I output one. So that's OR. And here's another, the exclusive OR is slightly different than OR. And what it says is if exactly one of my inputs is one, I output one. Otherwise, I output zero. So there's four bits here. What if we map those to a tile? Instead of mapping this function to the four sides of a tile, what happens if we map these four? So here's what it would look like. Here's the tile set I had before. All I'm going to do is just change, all I need to do to map that new function is just change these three output bits. So I'm changing these blues. This was a one, I'm making it a zero. This was a zero, I'm making it a one, et cetera. And then one more, I'm going to make one more little tweak. I'm going to make my bottom start out as one, you know, before it was a zero. But just these little tweaks to the tiles, it'd be pretty amazing. So anybody have any possible guess of like what system might emerge, what pattern rather than a binary counter? Yeah, because if you did, I'd feel really dumb because I would have had no idea the first time I saw it. But the Sierpinski triangle. So just by changing those couple bits, you get a completely different structure. It's an infinite aperiodic structure a discrete self-similar fractal known as the Sierpinski triangle. So just the change, and you get this pattern instead. So that really shows, you know, again, the algorithmic, you know, power here. You know, you and just like with a program, if anybody's ever written a, you know, a piece of computer code, you mean you can change one line of code and get a vastly different and usually, you know, not a good different output, but by just little changes, you can dramatically change the program that executes. And that's exactly the same here. Little change to the instructions. You know, we think of the tiles as being the instructions, and they're executed based on the rules of this system, and you get a vastly different output. So that's kind of, you know, some examples of algorithmic self-assembly. And as Chris pointed out before, I mean, here's a picture of that actually having been implemented. Here's the triangles, you know, of this pattern. So now we're going to step back. And who in here has ever seen a Turing machine? Anybody? A couple? Okay. So Alan Turing, considered to be, you know, the founder of computer science, he really came up with, you know, he was one of the pioneers of, you know, trying to figure out what does it mean to compute. You know, before we had any computing devices, it was a kind of a logical abstraction. Like, what does it mean to compute? You know, what's going on in our head when we solve problems? You know, what kind of things would we need to embed in some sort of a system so that system does what we think of as computing? And so he came up with this notion. He didn't call it a Turing machine, but what we call a Turing machine. In honor of him, but he wanted to come up with, you know, something like that. What's the simplest, you know, kind of abstract way to think of computing that might be able to do something interesting? And he came up with this idea. And in a Turing machine, the pieces of a Turing machine are a tape, and we can think of it as just going kind of an infinitely or arbitrarily long tape that just kind of goes off in the distance. And on each tape cell, it's divided into discrete cells. And each cell can hold exactly one value. In this particular example, they can either be blank, they can be a one, or they can be a zero. So that's all, you know, that's all that can be on a tape and any individual cell. The Turing machine consists of, we call it a read-write head. So it is some, you know, kind of physical component that can look at this tape, and it can look at exactly one cell. It can only see one cell at a time. That's all the power it has. It can look at one cell. It's standing on this cell, there's a zero there, or there's a one there. That's all it can do. And then the only other thing that a Turing machine does is it has a lookup table, kind of like the truth table I showed before, that has as inputs. So it basically has some discrete set of states that it can be in. In this particular example, I've got four states, and I've called them for historical reasons, Q0, Q1, Q2, and Q3. Those are just the names of the state. So when a Turing machine starts out, you just say, you know, it's by definition, it starts in some state, some initial state, and it's looking at one piece of data on one cell. And then the only thing a Turing machine can do is it can look at its truth table, its lookup table, and say, okay, what state am I currently in and what value am I looking at? And then the table tells me what to do next. So in this case, I start out in state Q0 and I'm looking at a one. So all the Turing machine does, it looks at the table, says, if I'm in Q0, I'm reading a one, I'm going to change the one to a zero. I'm going to move one step to the right. I can either move one step left or one step right. That's it. That's all I can do. And then I can say, what state am I in now? Okay. So that's all a Turing machine can do. So in this case, we're going to do that. So we're going to change that to a zero. We're going to move one step right. And now we're going to say, oh, I'm in state Q3. And now it does it again. It says, okay, I'm in Q3 reading a zero. I'm going to turn that to a one. I'm going to move right. And I'm going to say I'm in Q1. Okay, so it does that. And in Q1, in this example, Q1 reading a one, leaves it as a one. It moves one step left and says it's in state Q2. And then in this particular example, the only other thing a Turing machine can do is at some point, it's possible to get to a state where it says, oh, I'm in Q2 reading a one. I leave it a one and I halt. I'm all done. I don't need to step left or right. I'm just done. And that's it. So that's all a Turing machine can do. So he came up with this abstraction like, so it seems pretty simple, right? I can explain it in what it's like maybe 3-4 minutes. That's a Turing machine. Well, it turns out that this has been proven that Turing machines, so just by changing the lookup table is like writing a new program for it. So you can think of this as kind of like a programming language, and you can write a new program for it. It turns out that Turing machines can do anything that any digital computer can do, any circuit can do, any programming language can do, any of his advisor Alonzo Church had the lambda calculus. We turned out every method for computing that we know of in the universe, and the strong Church-Turing thesis is that any method of computing in this physical universe is no more powerful than a Turing machine. That's it. There's nothing in this universe that can compute and do something that a Turing machine cannot do. This captures all of the power of what it means to compute. Just by changing, if you want to compute a different program, you just change the lookup table and you can do something. And the amazing thing is, you're on Damien's. So Damien Woods, a friend and collaborator of ours, as theoreticians, we like to look for what's the simplest, right? Like, this is already pretty simple. Well, it turns out this model is so profound and complete and elegant that it turns out that there exist Turing machines where you can give them as input. So so the input is just like what bits were on the tape when it starts. That's the input, and then it runs for a while, and then whatever's left on the tape when it halts is the output. There exist Turing machines such that you can give them as their input a binary string that represents the rules of some other Turing machine, and the input that you give that Turing machine and this Turing machine will do exactly, it'll read the rules of the Turing machine that you gave it as input, and it'll do what that Turing machine would have done. So we say it simulates that Turing machine. And it turns out that there are Turing machines that can simulate any Turing machine. So there exists, there exists a lookup table for one particular Turing machine that for any Turing machine, and we've already said, that means for anything that could be computed by any physical device in the universe, there's some Turing machine that can do it. And then we can encode that Turing machine in a binary string and feed it to this universal Turing machine, and it can do it. So there exists singular Turing machines that can do what any Turing machine can do, which means they can compute anything. One of the cool things, like I said, so Damien Woods, who will be here next week, he, as a theoretician, we like to say, well, what's the simplest one of those? What's the simplest universal Turing machine? And I forget what it is. Is it 5 and 4?
It might be 5 and 6. It might be 5 and 4.
Okay, so.
What's your version?
Well, Damien got an efficient, so it only has like a quadratic, but so anyways, so you would think that if you're gonna write a program that can, operating system is like that, or the Java virtual machine or something, it can run any other program. Well, that's probably a pretty beefy program that can run any other program. They've come up with some whose rule table. In the example I gave, there's only 3 symbols you can have on the tape. In this one, I think there were 5 or 6 symbols that you could put on the tape. And then they only needed four or five states. So their lookup table isn't much bigger than this one. And it can compute anything that can be computed by anything. So it's incredibly powerful model, and very succinctly you can do incredibly powerful things. And so as theoreticians, we love it because, again, it's so simple and elegant, easy to discuss, and boom, this is it. You don't have to look at big circuit diagrams and say, what does it mean to compute? This is it. This captures it completely. So when we look at a model like the ATAM, we say, well, we saw that it could do some computations. We saw it could do binary arithmetic. We saw that it can compute this XOR function. Can it do what a Turing machine can do? Yes, it can. And I'll even give a quick example of how you can do that. So in the example I'm going to show, it turns out Turing machines, as long as their teeth goes arbitrarily far in one direction, that's enough. It can do anything. So in this example, I'm going to show you an ATAM system that, if you gave me a Turing machine, I could give you the tiles of a system that as it grows, it will, instead of computing, binary arithmetic, it will do what the Turing machine would have done. And basically the way that we do that is the north glues will encode the value of the tape, at that time step. And then one other thing. So when we look at a Turing machine, the information that's encoded in a Turing machine, a state of a Turing machine or a configuration is what's on its tape, where is it looking at this time step, and what state is it currently in? So what we do is we make our tiles such that instead of making just glues for 1, 0, and blank, we also make for the cross product of all states that it could be in. So we have a glue for if you're in state Q0 on a one, and we have a glue for if you're a Q0 reading a zero, we have a, you know, one for a Q1 reading one, et cetera. So, but, and so there's glues that represent all of those things. And then, you know, our initial seed, instead of just being a single tile, will be this row, such that the northern glues encode what were the values on the tape, and one of them encodes, it also encodes what state am I in, and that implicitly says where the head is looking. Okay, so now all you have to do is, it's a very simple exercise to look at the rules of the lookup table that define the Turing machine, and if it said, well, a Q0 reading a one, I think it moves right, changes it to a zero, goes to state Q3. What we do is in advance, you know, we look at the rules of the Turing machine and we make tiles that execute that logic. And so the tile in this case would be a tile whose southern glue matches the Q0 reading a one. And then its northern glue says, oh, now I'm a zero. And its eastern glue says, hey, Q3 should go over here. The head's going to be over here. And then we make a whole other set of tiles that, you know, for on my left was Q3 and I could be reading a zero, and there's another tile that could be reading a one, et cetera. And so, like I said, in advance, you just look at the Turing machine and you make these special, you know, the permutations of tiles for here and here that would do that embody the rules of that Turing machine. And then you basically just have kind of brain dead tiles that just copy. They just say, oh, if I was a one, I stay a one, et cetera. And then what happens is the row that grows up here, so this row represented the Turing machine when it started. This row represents a Turing machine after its first step of execution. And then if the Turing machine did this, the next row that grows up will completely encapsulate that step of the Turing machine. And if you know, you define the tiles to follow the rules of the transition table, when it's all done, you know, whenever the Turing machine would halt, we'll have an assembly whose top row encodes exactly what the Turing machine encoded when it was done. So we say that, so for any Turing machine there exists, we can make a tile set that will do this for that Turing machine. We say it simulates a Turing machine. So it basically encapsulates the computation of that Turing machine. So we say it simulates it, and therefore, since for any Turing machine this exists, we say that this model is computationally universal or Turing universal. If it can be done with a Turing machine, it can be done with tiles in this model. And we know that if it can be done on any computing device, it can be done with a Turing machine. Therefore, anything that you could compute on any, you know, following this thesis that hasn't yet been disproven, that there exists no physical computing device that's more powerful than a Turing machine. That means there's also no physical computing device that's more powerful than tiles in the ATAM. They can do it all. Yep.
What does it mean powerful exactly in this case? How do you mean, like the program that is more powerful? In which sense more powerful?
I just mean if it can be computed if there's anything, you know, if there was a binary circuit that could do it. There's a Turing machine program that can do it, and there's a tile set that can do it. So if it can be done by anything, it can be done by one of these. And then I use that word powerful just because it is possible to make computing systems that can't do everything a Turing machine can do. They can be weaker. Like if you don't give them, you know, a big enough tape or things like that, you can damage the model in ways that they can't do everything. But the Turing machine seems to be kind of like the simplest thing that can do it all. And does that kind of make sense? Cool. Okay, so this shows us if it can be done with an algorithm, it can be done in tile assembly. And what I find really fascinating is, you know, so you've got this computational power, this computational universality, but there's something going on here because as the system grows, that computation is embedded in its growth and it can't go away. Like so in the Turing machine, we can erase these, you know, we can change this to a zero, we can go back and forth over, you know, and so. You know, when it's done, you don't have any idea. Like maybe the head was here 4,000 times and it changed it, you know, 200 of them. You don't know. You just get the answer and the tape, you know, is still just the same tape. Here, that computation as it occurs is embedded in the structure that grows, right? So that influences how it grows. And so when we come up with algorithms that that we want to be able to direct the way that, that these systems grow. We embed in computations in them, and we'll see, like, you know, like, oh, I want it to grow up 100, then turn right or whatever. That computation, you know, isn't something that's done on a scratch pad and can be erased. It has to be embedded in the structure. So as you, you know, design these systems, you have to geometrically account for the way that the information moves through. You know, we kind of think of like the bits flowing through and, you know, the information going through the assembly. You have to account for that, because the geometry is important in this model. The computation happens, you know, it is embedded in the growth. So I don't have a ton of time, so let me just show a couple examples. But what I want to say is something that's important. So we said we can do arbitrarily complex algorithmic behavior can be realized by tiles. That cooperation, like when you noted, like, oh, what if a tile came in? If it only had to match one glue, has actually been proven by Damien that you can't do anything algorithmically interesting. You can't do binary counting. You can't do Turing machine simulation. You can't do anything interesting. You need that cooperative behavior. So it's a very simple thing, but without it, you have, you know, almost no power. And with it, you have unlimited computational power. And it turns out that there are different ways that you can achieve this cooperation. Instead of like saying you've got to bind with two strength one glues, you can do weird stuff where tiles are bumpy and they kind of have like patterns on them that allow them to like block each other out. Or you could have like glues that have repulsive forces. There are other ways to realize this cooperative behavior. But you know, I'd be happy to talk about that more. But like I said, I just want to show a couple with just the limited time left. So okay, so what? So you can embed a computation, you know, in tiles, but who cares, right? Like, why would I want to simulate a Turing machine? Well, you probably don't really want to simulate a Turing machine. We just do it to prove that you can. It just shows the expressive power of this model. You could do it if you wanted to, but really, what are we trying to do? We're trying to build things, and we're trying to use the algorithms to direct how they're built. And so, for instance, we're able to show that, like, it's kind of a benchmark problem in the area. Say, like, well, what if I want to start from a single seed tile and have the assembly grow for you give me some input value of n, say 2004, and I'll give you a tile set that will start from a single tile and it will grow a square whose dimensions are 2004 by 2004, and it'll stop at exactly that size, right? So that's where, you know, at least in my mind, becomes interesting, where you can use the algorithm to dictate the shape of what gets built. And so one really easy way to do that in this model would be to make, like just to make it a little bit easier, let's say I wanted to make it 1,000 by 1,000 for my N. One thing I could do is I could make 1 million tile types that are like the puzzle piece example I showed before, where there's a specific tile that goes here and it has a unique glue to its north and its east that is not shared by anybody else except for the tile that I want to go there. And I make a unique tile for every single position. And so with only a million tile types, I could make a system that makes 1,000 by 1,000 square. Okay, but algorithmically, we can show that, in fact, you can do it with effectively log n tile types, which is log n grows very slow compared to n. So for instance, the way that it works is you're making the tiles that basically do all of the square except for this row will be generic for no matter what value of n you give me. But whatever value of n you give me, I'm going to make a set of tiles that basically encode that number, which you know, for a number n, you need log n bits to encode the number n. And I'm going to make that many tiles that are going to grow out of the row. And then all the other tiles are generic and they work for any n. They just count using that number. They know how high to count. And then from that, there's just these like six tiles that can grow in and use that height and know that they just grow on a diagonal. So if you grew up that high, I'm going to grow out that high and wide. And we do that down the bottom. And you make the square that's exactly your n. And this gets interesting. So like I said, for 1,000 by 1,000, you know, if you made special tiles for each place, you need a million tile types. If you use this construction, then you need 24. And if you want to make this a billion by a billion, you need a billion square tile types, or you need 36 tiles to do it algorithmically. So, you know, so the, you know, it's profoundly powerful in terms of you know, getting to, you know, reuse tile, you get the algorithm to drive it, and you can very efficiently use a small number of kinds of tiles to build very complex things. I'm pretty much out of time. So I just like, so there are ways you can get really crazy constructions. And this is what I, for some reason, they keep letting me do it for a living. And I come up with these ridiculous constructions that drive Turing machines around and make these crazy constructions, but just to see what you can build. And so you can really make, you know, complex shapes. And I think what I'll do is I'll stop and take questions, and then I can talk about some other stuff afterwards if people are interested. So with that, so there's some time for questions or comments. So
thank you. So we started a few minutes late, but let's have a few questions. Chris?
Yeah, so that was really great, thanks. So I like proving that this works as a Turing machine. I'm just wondering if you could talk a little bit about speed, resource use, that sort of thing, because often these biological devices are amazing in terms of accuracy, speed, and energy use. I'm just wondering, compared to digital computers, how do the tiles compare?
This model, so one of the, you know, one of the issues with this model is the irreversible nature of it. So as the Turing, like every step of the Turing machine is forever embedded. So however many steps that Turing machine took, that means that's how big your thing has to be. So it's grossly inefficient from that perspective. Like you would never want to, you know, you're not going to efficiently compute in this. Like you can use the computation to guide the shape you're going to get, but you would never want to, you're not going to, you know, oh, I just want to compute with this. You want to use the computation to drive what grows, but the resource. Now there are models where detachment can occur. Like you can turn glues on and off, and you get much more efficient. You know, so your assembly never gets any bigger than the tape of the Turing machine that would have been used, and you know, you'd be more efficient. But in this very basic version of the model, with only irreversible attachments, you just have this monotonic growth, and so it's not, you know, it's grossly inefficient, like as far as a computing platform.
Yep. Cool. Seems to me that a lot of what you see is based on the nature of the sticky ends. And it doesn't need to be DNA, it can be any molecule.
That's right.
And so you can play with molecules that can be more generalist or have a different probabilities or different affinities and go into the continuum.
And even different shapes too, right? It doesn't need to be just say, I mean, you know, like, even with DNA, we've got all these, you know, crazy like polyomino shapes and things that they don't only touch four other tiles, they touch a whole bunch of other things like shape, everything. So this is just an abstraction. Like, again, just like the Turing machine is like, let's look at the simplest way we can think about this. But you're absolutely right. And it's such an abstraction that it's not actually tied to, like, yes, it so happens to be that people have made these out of DNA. But yes, you could hopefully, I mean, that's what I was like, that's why it's kind of fun to, you know, think about it abstractly anyways, because it's independent of how what molecules you might be able to build with. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So just like looking at it, these systems look a lot like cellular automata.
Yeah.
And I was wondering, like, and so cellular automata can also be Turing complete. I was wondering if there was any like significant differences between the two models.
The reuse of space. Right, right. Because a cellular automaton, the same cell can be a zero, then a one, then a zero, an arbitrary number of times.
Right.
Where in this model, once a tile goes in that location, it never changes. Right. So I had a result a long ago, which a cellular automata can simulate this, like a freezing cellular automata. If you're familiar with that, where this, you know, once its state changes from its, you know, its original state, it can only change one time and it can never change again.
Right.
So it's like a very even simpler. Even that simple version of cellular automata can simulate tiles, but for tiles to simulate cellular automata, I like to come up with ridiculous constructions. And there's this one where what it does is at ever increasing scale, like it, you know, it basically, you know, builds out, you know, and kind of reads the information of neighbors and figures out like what the cell should be at the next value at the next time step. And then the whole grid, it starts with some finite size grid, but then that becomes one cell. You know, and the scale just keeps going out. So now at a bigger scale, it simulates it. You know, and then that becomes one cell of the next larger because of the irreversible nature of tile attachments here. So you don't get to reuse space in this model. And that's really the fundamental difference.
It seems like there's something that it can do that cellular automata can't, which is you could have some kind of like indeterminacy or something, because you can have two glues that correspond to multiple different tiles or something like that.
Yeah.
I haven't seen that in cellular automata, right? So is that something?
Non-deterministic.
Yeah, there are. Yeah, exactly. You could define non-deterministic rule sets for CA. But that's one of the things that's like when you're programming these systems, it can be hard because sometimes you have a goal in mind, but like one part of the assembly grows faster and it blocks out the part that you wanted, or there's, you know, there are a variety of ways that non-determinism can arise in this model.
Mm-hmm. So, although he had to leave, I know he had a 1:30 meeting. You know, when Aviv asked about, well, what if you're trying to do this counting and, you know, you have the scaffolding growing up on this side and something that shouldn't be there, you know, was not here. And of course, in the abstract model, you can say, well, yes, but we can use the 1 versus 2 glues to prevent that from happening. But, you know, in sort of chemical or physical reality, there would be some chance that would show up, and then you know it would take a while to fall back off again. And so some of these constructions, it seems like, unless there's an infinite energy difference, the probability that the construction will actually work properly decreases exponentially.
So you almost defined, so when Eric defined the ATAM, he also defined the KTAM, the kinetic tile assembly model, and that models attachment and detachment rates, so forward and backward, and the backward rate is dependent upon how strongly it sticks, but the forward rate only is depending on the concentration. So tiles can come in if they match with 0 glues, 1 or 2, and then how quickly they dissociate depends on how he's able to show mathematically that you can actually, the KTAM, you could see errors like crazy if you set concentrations and energy, like the temperature of the system and stuff, in certain ways, you just have rampant bad growth. Like things just attach with 1 instead of 2 and the algorithm gets messed up. But you can also tune it such that if you make the concentrations low enough in the limit, you could slow down the assembly so much. You make the concentrations so low that attachment rate is way less, or you know the detachment rate is so high that before a bad tile can get locked in, it'll fall out. So in the limit, in that model, you get ATAM behavior, and that's that when we implement it in the lab. And there are other like error correcting mechanisms, just like just same types of codes we use in networks and stuff to like bit redundancy and stuff. You can encode in tile systems and make them more robust. But yes, it exactly. This is an abstract version, and there are other models that are more closer to physical reality that capture these errors. And those are what we use once we design the algorithm in this model. Then we model it in that more chemically realistic model, and we put in these error correction mechanisms before we actually try to put it in the test tube because those errors will happen.
I understand. So here's my question, which is a theory question.
Okay.
So you're trying to build an n by n square with log n or log over log log different kinds of tiles. So you could imagine that partly because this construction is so efficient that it has, this binary counter has to work perfectly all the way up to the top. So you could imagine that there's an exponential difficulty in building that, which can be ameliorated in several ways. You can make the gap between the energies large enough so that the wrong growth is exponentially suppressed. Mm-hmm. You can make the concentration of the wrong tiles exponentially small so that that's suppressed. But then in some cases, this would also make the process exponentially slow.
Exactly.
And so that one way or the other, because I mean, in a lot of models of physical computation, like you can trade off energy for time. Mm-hmm. You can have something which either takes exponential time or requires you to pump exponential energy through it or whatever. That there's some exponential difficulty which can be compensated for one way or the other, but that it's hard to, And so I'm just wondering if there are trade-offs where the really efficient in terms of the size of the tile set constructions sometimes are, you know, have this difficulty, mm-hmm. but maybe there's some other version with more tiles. Mm-hmm. For instance, you say more error correction, more redundancy.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. You know, so have people kind of started to map out that frontier between, you know, that sort of trade-off?
Yeah, and like you can show, like, you know, with the error correction, like, I mean, if you, you know, you can, you know, with like quadratic blow up, you can get exponential, you know, error correction. I think that, yeah, there's absolutely, you know, those trade-offs are, and then the yeah, and interestingly, in the, for the implementations in the lab that have been done, it becomes very important to carefully balance the concentrations of temperature, but the error correction mechanisms that have actually worked quite well are some of the very simplest, like, but we have theoretically more powerful ones, but totally. The trade-offs are absolutely there. Like complexity of the number of unique kinds of tiles versus, you know, the fidelity of the system or the speed, and yeah, absolutely.
All right. Well, I think we should thank